Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here with you, and I would like also to thank especially Dr. Frangos for this invitation. My presentation will be on the role of external beam radiation therapy in patients with thyroid cancer. And in summary, I will try to cover four main topics. We'll see some data, if there are any data, about the role of radiation therapy in the three main histologic subtypes of thyroid cancer. We'll see some data for differentiated thyrocarcinoma, for medullary, for anaplastic, and after that, some basic principles of radiation therapy treatment planning for thyroid cancer. And finally, I will close my presentation with conclusion. First of all, I have to say that there are no prospective controlled trials for DTC. The main problem is that all of them have failed of concerns regarding inadequate number of patients. But despite this lack of randomized prospective studies, we have data from retrospective analysis that show that external beam radiation therapy might be effective for local disease control with a little effect on overall survival. There is a retrospective study with patients older than 40 years of age with locally advanced papillary carcinomas, T4 disease with lymph node involvement, and with adjuvant external beam radiation therapy, there was a benefit for those patients. Another study reported increase in specific, in co-specific survival and local relapse-free rate in patients with microscopic residual disease. More data from retrospective studies. If we offer external beam radiation therapy in patients with residual disease, microscopic or macroscopic, those patients are commonly disease-free after external beam radiation therapy compared to those who do not receive it. More or less, the results for follicular carcinoma are the same. So the application of adjuvant external beam radiation therapy in differentiated thyrocarcinoma remains controversial. The reason is that because we don't have data from prospective studies. Individually, we can say that patients undergoing multiple and frequent serial neck reoperation, they can receive external beam radiation therapy mainly for palliation. According to the American Thyroid Association guidelines published this year, recommendation number 60 is saying that there is no role for routine adjuvant external beam radiation therapy to the neck in patients with DTC after initial complete surgical removal of the tumor. Strong recommendation, but with low quality of evidence. According to the NCCN guidelines, if we have gross residual disease and this disease is inadequate or adequate with RAI uptake, then we can consider external beam radiation therapy. Let's go now to medullary thyroid carcinoma. In medullary thyroid carcinoma, total thyroidectomy is the primary treatment. Adjuvant radiation therapy is rarely used to treat these patients. And external beam radiation therapy can play a role in patients at high risk for local recurrence. There is an analysis of the SIR database from 1988 to 2004, and we saw that adjuvant external beam radiation therapy showed no overall survival in these patients with positive lymph nodes. Although there are no improvement in overall survival, we know that with external beam radiation therapy, we can achieve local control in patients at, which are at high risk for local recurrence. The five-year locoregional relapse-free survival rate was 87%, and the disease-specific and overall survival rates were 62 and 56, respectively. So there are multiple reports to so that we can control locally the disease with external beam radiation therapy. We know that the long-term survival of patients with medullary thyroid carcinoma is determined by the metastatic disease to liver, bone, or brain, and probably local control of the disease makes it possible to apply new treatments. And we are happy to say that the last years there are new treatments for these patients. So who is candidate for external beam radiation therapy? Patients with several recurrences in the neck or upper mediastinum in whom additional surgery would be difficult. When we have microscopic extension of tumor from the thyroid gland or lymph nodes into soft tissue of the neck, of course, for patients with localized unresectable disease and for symptomatic metastatic disease, radiation therapy can offer palliation. According to the American Thyroid Association, recommendation 52, postoperative adjuvant external beam radiation therapy to the neck and mediastinum should be considered in patients at high risk for local recurrence. For patients with residual disease, microscopic or macroscopic, for extrathyroidal extension or extensive lymph node involvement and extranodal extension into soft tissue of the neck. Recommendation 61 and 62, we can use external beam radiation therapy for palliation, for cutaneous metastasis or bone metastasis. And the NCC guidelines recommend more or less the same things for locally advanced disease, T4 disease, positive surgical margins, extranodal extension. Now, for anaplastic thyroid carcinoma, radiation therapy alone has not been shown to alter disease outcome. But when we combine radiation therapy with surgery and chemotherapy, it shows some improvement in survival. For patients who have undergone R1, R2 resections or have unresected disease, patients with good performance status, we can offer definitive radiation therapy with or without chemotherapy. Patients, of course, with local symptoms can be treated with palliative radiation therapy. Here we see the NCCA guidelines for R1, R2 resection. External beam radiation therapy might be an option. And, of course, for palliative locoregional treatment. The problem always for a radiation oncologist is where to shoot, where is the areas at high risk for recurrence that we have to cover with a good dose of radiation. So for thyroid cancer, we know exactly what to cover. So here, we see the node levels. This is level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5 at the back of the sternocleidoid muscle. This is level 6 and level 7. So for thyroid cancer, the low-risk clinical target volume typically includes level 2 to 5 in the node-negative disease and the level at the upper mediastinum, level 7, to the carina. The high-risk clinical target volume includes the preoperative thyroid bed, the central nodal compartment, level 6, and we have to cover level 2 through 5, all these areas, when we have node-positive neck. In radiation therapy, it's very helpful to use imaging. This is helpful to ensure accurate target volume delineation, and we use CT scan, MRI, and PET when this is available. The dose that we must give in the adjuvant setting, when we have subclinical disease, it's about 60 gray delivered to the thyroid bed. When we have gross residual disease, we have to escalate the dose to 70 gray for effective local control. Always we use CT scan for the treatment planning, and we said it before that the target volume encompasses the thyroid bed extending from the ioid bone to the carina. We have to cover also, we said, some different levels of the lymph nodes in the neck if there is positive or negative lymph nodes. In generally, when we treat patients with cancer in the area of the head and neck area, conformal techniques are ideally suited. And there are dosimetric studies, and we know that when we use modern techniques of radiation therapy, like IMRT, we can escalate the dose to the primary tumor, and while we can spare the dose from normal critical organs around the area of interest. And for thyroid cancer patients, these organs are spinal cord, parotid glands, and the mandible. This is a linear accelerator. This is the equipment that we use to deliver treatment. This is the gantry of the machine. This is the table for the patient. And this is a low energy CT scanner, so we can perform combeam CT. That means that we can scan the area before the treatment, and we can offer image-guided radiation therapy. The next step of IGRT is intensity modulated radiation therapy. We use thermoplastic mask system for immobilization. So after this mask, we have to go to the CT scanner. So we scan the area of the neck. And after that, we have something like that. This is a case of a patient with medullary carcinoma after operation with residual disease and extranodal extension into soft tissue of the neck. Here we are at the upper part of the neck. We see here the bone, the mandible. This thin red line is the target volume for the low risk areas, and we deliver here a dose about 60 gray. We see here the parotid glands. We must keep the mean dose lower than 26 gray to prevent any permanent dry mouth. And you see that we can spare the dose from the spinal cord. We keep the dose lower than 45 gray. Lower, we see how conformally we can cover all this area and spare the dose from the spinal cord. Here we are at the area with the residual disease at the right side. This is the thyroid cartilage. The dose here is higher. It's about 70 gray. You see the dose here about 60 gray. Lower to the neck, the same. Here we are at the level 3 of lymph nodes with extranodal disease. The dose here will be higher, about 66 gray. The dose to the low risk target volume, we said about 60 gray. Here we are at level 7 of the lymph nodes. You see that we can spare the dose from the lungs. And here lower, you see that we can cover this area. And the dose will be, again, 60 gray. And in a sagittal and coronal view, this is the area that we cover, the bottom of the neck to the carina. And this is a 3D reconstruction of the treatment plan. All this red area is the area that we have to cover. All these lines are the fields of radiation that we use. Here, this is the spinal cord, the parotid glands. In radiation therapy, we have a very useful tool. This tool is dose volume histogram. And with this tool, we can know exactly the dose we give to the primary tumor and to the normal tissues around the area of interest. Now, there are, of course, and some side effects with radiation therapy. There are some acute side effects. These side effects are mucositis. We might see some skin reactions, skin erythema, dry mouth, xerostomia, and it's not so common to see some airway edema. The late effects, dry mouth. This side effect depends on the technique of radiation therapy that we use. We know from many randomized data, mainly from laryngeal and nasopharyngeal carcinoma, that when we use IMRT technique, the incidence of dry mouth is much lower. We'll see fibrosis of the soft tissue of the neck and sometimes possible esophageal stenosis. In conclusion, the mainstay of treatment in thyroid cancer is surgery. The role of external beam radiation therapy is limited. There are no prospective randomized trials to support the use of external beam radiation therapy in thyroid cancer, but according to retrospective studies, seems that external beam radiation therapy might be helpful in patients with differentiated thyroid carcinoma with adequate or inadequate dry uptake, in patients with medullary thyroid carcinoma at high risk for local recurrence, and here we have to deal with residual disease, microscopic or macroscopic, extrathyroidal extension, extranodal extension into soft tissue of the neck. For patients with anaplastic thyroid carcinoma following resection for R1, R2, postoperative external beam radiation therapy might be an option. Of course, in patients with unresectable disease, radiation therapy can offer palliation to the patient. And of course, for palliation when we have distant metastasis. I would like to close my presentation with that there is the need for prospective randomized studies to establish the benefit or not of external beam radiation therapy in patients with thyroid cancer. What I recommend you is that when you have a patient with thyroid cancer and you don't know exactly what to do, if you don't have more options, radiation therapy could be an option. So speak with your radiation oncologist.